It's 28 minutes past the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Jillian sitting here for Laurie, Tom, Bob the Puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer, and here's the whole gang.
All right, Jim, wait a minute. Vladimir from Russia is going to take a picture of us. Smile. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
It's somebody, a Polaroid, so we'll see how it comes
somebody
out.
Somebody confiscate that camera quickly.
Jim, your USA Today is just a big white dot.
Is it?
What's the word of the day?
Wow. Well, listen, I know that you guys have been muttering behind my back that we've been taking up too much time with word of the day. So, Maestro. We have been taking up too much time.
We need a new toaster. Yeah. Is that what we need?
It's placate. And that's what I've just done is I've tried to placate you, which indicates that I've made a concession in order to pacify a situation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. To make us happy.
That's right. Okay. To make you happy. I'm placating you by getting through this quickly, but then I didn't get through it quickly, so I've antagonized you, and that's tomorrow's word of the day.
Now, Sergey, who is one of the guests of our visiting family from Franklin, Massachusetts, and you are from where in Russia?
From Moscow.
From Moscow. Could you use placate, our word of the day, in a Russian sentence? Yes.
The word in the Russian language, which sounds the same way, maybe in a different, with a different meaning.
Okay.
So, плакаты.
Плакаты.
Yeah. That was
easy. Вы можете видеть плакаты везде по Москве?
Плакаты. Whoa.
Keeping in mind it's a family show.
And that's the word in Russian and English, right?
There you go.
All right, thanks, Jim. And thank you, sir. Yeah. That was very nice. Yeah. Very nice.
Right now, we're going to be joining John Davis, who is in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Now, John, you're at the Sawgrass Recreation Park, which is the Florida Everglades or the Sea of Grass. It's called the Sea of Grass, John, because there's only 6 inches of water over a thick layer of grass, and you're going to be looking for alligators. Good luck.
We're out here, Jillian. I'm holding this up so I can hear you. You know, behind me, I am surrounded by about 8 million acres of swampland, of the marsh here. And in the state of Florida, we have about 1.5 million alligators. And we're going to do some alligator hunting, Jillian. You ready for this?
I don't know. Be careful.
Have you ever been on an airboat before?
Never. What's it like?
It's exciting. We're going to show you exactly what it's like. I grew up in Naples, Florida, right across the Everglades here, so I'm kind of used to this airboat stuff. But here's a man who knows a heck of a lot about gators, a heck of a lot about airboats. It's Captain Danny. How you doing, Captain Danny?
Pretty good. Chilly.
I know. Jillian, I brought my bathing suit for this trip. It's still in my bag. It's freezing down here. All right, we're out here. We want to find some gators. Is it a guaranteed thing that we're going to find gators?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. Why? Because it's cold, so they're going to stay down too, right?
Cold-natured animals, very hard to find in this weather.
Okay, now we're going to go on an airboat ride, so what should we look for?
Look for any movement in the water at all. If it is, chances are it's an alligator. Look for anything that looks like a dead chunk of wood floating in the water. Not got a lot of trees around here, so chances are it's a gator.
Because that's all you'll see out of the water is the head, the eyes, and the back, right?
Most of the time.
Okay, now, do you have a gator call, just in case we get out there and we need to call one?
We use the baby call a lot for the alligators.
Okay. What's it sound like?
The gator chewing on our cable, John.
Okay. And the adult gators sound like huge, like monster bullfrogs, right?
Sound like a souped-up bullfrog.
Okay, let's get going. Let's take this airboat ride. Now, what do we have? We're on an airboat, but what kind of an engine do we have back here, Danny?
Most of these engines here are automotive engines, old Cadillac motors.
Okay, well, let's go. We'll all sit down. Everybody, Lincoln's the cameraman. Come on, Link, let's take a seat. Everyone sit down, and Jillian, we're going on an airboat ride.
All right, hope you find them.
All right, here we go.
All right. Now, John did say that we might have a little bit of trouble hearing because it's very noisy out there, but we're just going to let him roll with it.
Yeah.
And what's he got? For the moment, a lot of blades of grass. And
there's some more grass.
Some static.
There's some more grass.
Does anybody see any gators out there? You got one? You saw one hitting. Have they got one? alligators?
I guess the noise doesn't bother them.
Do you see any? You see any gators, Danny? Not yet. He's saying
not
no.
Yet.
Let's go some more. Let's check it out.
For the moment, it's only grass, John. No gators yet. Have you seen a gator, Spencer?
No.
No. Okay.
Yes, but it's fascinating grass.
I've never seen grass like this before. Yeah.
Craig mentioned it looks like a hair transplant bird's eye view.
Maybe John needs to make a few gator calls.
All right. Now, Danny, let's kill this for a minute.
That's a good idea.
We must find some gators. Yeah. All right, now, this is a spot where you're used to spotting them, right?
Yes, sir. Uh-huh. What we'll do is look for these tree lines and things like that where the gator can get a little shelter from the wind and soak up a little sunshine in the process.
Okay, well, what we're going to do, Jillian, that was an airboat ride. We're still in search of gators, so hopefully we'll find one when we come back.
All right, John, good luck. Right now, we've got Tom with some of today's top stories.
I think we should all leave Spencer and Jillian alone for a few minutes, don't you? It's the defense's turn to give opening arguments today in O.J. Simpson's trial, but only after Judge Ito makes a key decision. He's considering banning TV cameras from the courtroom because an alternate juror was caught on camera yesterday. Republicans say President Clinton talked about cutting government in his State of the Union address, and now he must, quote, walk the walk. In the GOP response, New Jersey Governor Christine Todd Whitman suggested Clinton must work with her party or get out of the way. Much of Southern California is under a flash flood watch this morning. More than 2 inches of rain has been dumped in Los Angeles since Monday, the most rainfall the area has seen in 100 years. And finally, Trekkie Heaven is heading to Las Vegas. Paramount Parks yesterday unveiled plans for an attraction called Star Trek The Experience, where visitors can participate in simulated space missions. Heck, if you want to have a space-time anomaly, just come on in here, have breakfast with us.
Yeah.
That's a look at some of today's top stories, Jillian.
All right, now that we've got those top stories, what's going on in the...
On the West Coast and in the Southwest, we also have some snow in this area here. And as you can see, we have these very professionally made spiky yellow
they
balls.
They look like cave drawings.
Well, no, they can't be cave drawings because there's bright sunshine.
Ah.
Cave drawing would be something like this, you know, more along this line. But look at this. There's a whole good area here. Let's check out the high temperatures. As you can see, the high temperatures are low. We still have the beaver of 50s looking to the east, and that is the weather.
How about a little mailbag music, maestro?
Wait. Hey, 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 Mr. Postman. Mr. Postman, look at me. Oh, yeah.
And when we get there, everybody wants to sing the background.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Huh? No? Because if somebody has to sing it on pitch.
Oh.
On pitch. We got this letter from William R. Bill Head.
Help.
And here's a picture of Bill Head's head right now. He works for Sun Realty.
That's redundant.
I love breakfast time. It is such a pleasure to laugh in the morning with the breakfast time folks. We hope to have you around for a long, long time. With Spencer here on North Carolina's beautiful Outer Banks, thought you might like to see that breakfast time made the front page of our local Coastland Times newspaper. There's Spencer there. Was looking forward to seeing Spencer at Jockey's Ridge State Park this morning, but of course the power went out. Congratulations on a great morning program. Say hi to Bob.
Yeah.
Nice.
No present?
No, well,
no gift?
Here's a picture of Bill Head's head.
Oh, it's his business card. Good, in case I want to buy a house.
Yeah, there you go.
Everyone is very nice in North Carolina, by the way. Yeah. It seems like as we go on the road more and more and more, I know you don't have the opportunity to be out there because we're not on the New York. It's okay. But you can live vicariously through us road warriors. But everyone's been very nice. The media's been nice. The locals have been very nice and friendly. So
well,
it's a good feeling that viewers are there.
When's Tom in the Box going out again, Paul? Later this week, Tom in the Box will allow me to be out somewhere.
There you go.
In the hinterland.
And you too, Tom, can be on front page headlines.
That's right. That's
all right, we have a letter here. Dear Lori, Tom, Bob, and the Breakfast Time gang, I started watching Breakfast Time while on maternity leave in September. once Nicole, this is Nicole, was born, isn't it, Kitty? 9:29, and we were up in the mornings. We watched Breakfast Time and then took a nap. The only time we had the TV on in the afternoons was to watch Steve Walker on the Pet Department. Thank you for bringing back Bob Keeshan. Unfortunately, I'm back at work, and I can only catch an hour or so while getting ready, so I hope you're watching us right now. At least I can see a couple of shows on the weekend. P.S. Nicole fell asleep after the show was over. Good timing, Nicole.
Where are they writing from?
Yeah,
they are writing us
the
from
yeah.
San Carlos, California. It is John and Carol Keelty.
By the way, we all fall asleep right after the show, too. don't feel funny. Now, you've won. Yeah. Bill Head and our gang from California have won a fine new 100% cotton FX T-shirt.
Wow.
How do you write? How do you call?
Well, you write to us at Breakfast Time, P.O. Box 824 Madison Square Station, New York, New York, 10159-0824. Or you call us at 212-802-4054. Or you fax us at 212-802-4208. If we read your letter on the air, you get one of those snappy T-shirts.
Vladimir, I know you don't speak English, so, and is Vladimir from Moscow as well? All right. This is the fresh toast. The fresh toast was made by Ed. Ed, come over here. Ed made the French toast, sacré bleu. You will get an upset tummy if you eat Ed's French toast. Can you say, hey, hey, in Russian, ho? Oh, yeah.
Same thing. It's the same thing.
What else is coming up, Jim?
How the police are using the body heat of criminals to get them into the cooler. Thermal imaging coming up on Breakfast Time.
Vernon Shaw from FX News, bringing you the headlines you need from across the country and around the world every hour. He keeps you connected through
every night at 6, 5 Central, only on FX.
It's 18 minutes to the top, 15 minutes to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom, Jillian, sitting in for Lori, Bob, the puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer. And here's Jillian and Tom
and Danielle Brisebois. Archie Bunker didn't know what he had. Welcome.
Yeah.
Good to have you here.
Good to be here.
Now, you've seen Breakfast Time at your dad's place in Florida?
I've seen Breakfast Time in Florida at my dad's house. Yep.
That's
great. Cool.
But you live in New York.
I live in New York.
Right.
But I was in Florida for New Year's Eve and I saw the show.
You saw these crazy people running around. You said, I've got to be a part of it.
Actually, and my friend actually did the makeup too here. So I felt very at home coming here today.
Okay. Well, cool. You have a seat because you do a lot of flying.
Oh, my
right?
gosh.
And
so much.
You've got some bad news in store here.
I know. Brace yourself, Danielle.
I'll leave Jillian and her guests to break it to you, Danielle.
Uh-oh. I'll break it to you. The news is pretty bad. It's starting February 1st at most major airlines now. They're going to increase the number of miles that you need in order to get that free flight. They're going to increase it by about 25%. And Smart Money Magazine's travel columnist Everett Potter is here to tell us what we can do to get the most out of our miles before that February 1st
That's
deadline.
Right. That's right. We're going up from 20,000 to 25,000 miles for the airlines on American, Continental, United, and Northwest. So if you've got miles in American right now, and you've got 20,000 miles, act before the end of the month.
Okay.
Go before January 31st.
So precisely, what can we do on specific airlines? Let's say, what are some of the things we can do on American as opposed to Delta, Continental,
right,
et cetera?
American right now, you want to call up or write to them and cash in your miles by the end of the month. You're going to get a certificate that's good for a year, and that certificate is going to get you a ticket that's good for another year. So you're talking about travel for the next 2 years,
right,
which is fantastic.
Become gold now because it was 25,000 to become gold.
You're
which I became last year. No, not that. You just travel so much. You get your mileage.
You
get
you
wrapped
travel
up
so much. You don't have much to worry about because we're only going up 5,000 miles. It's the poor suckers.
So
you've only got 20,000 miles.
To become gold instead of 25,000 a year.
Yeah.
To become gold. Okay.
Yeah, it's going up.
Okay.
Okay.
Does this mean that we should change maybe the way that we fly? Should we think about after February 1st?
I think it means we should change the way we shop. You were saying earlier that everyone should shop for 10 minutes a day. Use a card that gives you miles.
Another thing to shop for.
Absolutely.
Add 10 packages on
Great
Saturday.
Great reason to go shopping.
What about trips to Europe? There's a lot of people.
Europe are going up another 10,000 to 15,000 miles depending on the airline you're going to be on. American's going up 10,000. Continental's going up that 15.
Okay. And how else can we beat this whole frequent flyer thing. A lot of times you can get miles not only by flying, but by calling or by dining in restaurants.
What if American has this thing where you can now get 3 miles for every dollar you spend in restaurants that are affiliated with the program? You can send flowers and get miles these days. You can send packages and get miles these days. That's apart from
AT&T has a deal with the telephone if you
indeed
make long distance calls.
MCI is fantastic too in that regard too. You
well,
get 2,000 miles.
Bob, but
AT&T is here, so let's keep it with the people who show up.
Okay? Oh, we love AT&T.
With the dining thing, people ask me like, I want to pay the bill. I need miles.
That's right. That's right. Eating for miles. Forget the exercise.
Right. Okay. So, in a little wrap up, the three things that we can do if we've got some
miles.
Okay. With
American Act now, if you've got Continental miles, you've got till the end of the month to get your cash them in, and you get a ticket that's good for 6 months. Any changes all you want that you want to make are fine and they're free. And the other thing is United. If you want to fly on United, you got 20,000 miles. Get ticketed by January 31st, and then you have a year to fly anywhere you want to go.
Okay.
And
thanks
remember,
a lot.
And remember, puppets fly free.
Puppets fly free. And Danielle, you are not in the red because you're a gold person, so you'll catch up those miles pretty quickly.
I should go cash them in, though, probably before last year.
Right. Thank you for that good advice. Thank you, Everett Potter from Smart Money Magazine. Tom, you are...
I'm over here where Ed is getting some Reiki treatment, the healing power of Reiki therapy, which is a specialty of Patricia Warren of Franklin, Massachusetts, who is also a justice of the peace, so she can marry you while you're doing this. Ed, if you like. What are you doing to Ed?
We're doing Reiki. We're just putting our hands on him, and our hands are heating up, and he's relaxing. He was choking and coughing.
Really? Yeah. You've been eating your own French toast, huh? How are you? Is this making any difference?
I'm relaxed. My throat seems to have settled down.
Is that right? And are you accessing, like, his aura or something like that?
Universal energy.
Yeah.
Universal energy. Yeah.
Could you do me a favor? Because we have a guy who's been filling in for our regular director down in the booth.
Sure.
Bob is down there.
Yeah.
And he could. I think he could do. Bob, would you like some of this healing energy?
Absolutely.
All right. Would you go down and just touch him a lot?
Yeah.
All right.
It's much cheaper than the Thorazine.
Are you all centered now?
Yes. I'm all better.
All right. Now
he's sweating. Look at him.
Salami, bologna.
Now, whether you're getting Reiki therapy and having sort of your aura aligned, or whether you're trying to evade police, there's just no way of getting around the fact that we're giving off energy all the time. It's just, it's coming out of our pores, right, Danielle?
Always.
It's yes,
very true,
it is. It's very true, and we're going to find out how our infrared signal, if you will, can be used to find us even in the darkness of night.
We have an infrared signal.
Yes, we do. We do. We're just oozing infrared.
Is that like your aura?
Your aura now
has another layer.
That's right. It's like layering for the cold. You have an aura over the aura infrared. Antony Beilinsohn, who up until today was only a humble producer on the show, is filling in for Suzanne Wong. In Portland, Oregon, Suzanne got hit with a bit of stomach flu, and Antony goes from humble producer to future difficult talent. Hi, Antony.
Good morning. If anybody needs that therapy, I swear I need it today out here. Let me explain to you what we're going to do this morning. I have with me Dave Strong from Flir Systems. And what we're going to do is we're going to show how infrared technology is helping police fight crime and helping them reduce crime. Now, let's take a shot of our helicopter up in the air. We have a shot of the helicopter. Now, we're going to recreate a crime situation here. We have two cars. One is our criminal, and one is our police car. So let's start the crime situation, Dave. And what's happening is our helicopter is going to help the police fight the crime. Now, explain to us what we're actually seeing here, Dave.
What we're seeing is an infrared image. The camera, the FLIR, we call it, makes what looks like a black and white TV image, but it's making the image of heat differences, temperature differences, and so it works equally well day or night.
Now, what's actually happening? There's a camera attached to the helicopter?
Yes, it's mounted below the helicopter in a turret that allows the operator to point it wherever he wants, and then he can create the image and look at the image either with the FLIR, the infrared camera, or a TV camera, which we'll show you in a minute.
Now how is this kind of technology different from night vision devices that we, you know, see the Army using?
Well, it works without any ambient light, so it works in total darkness. You can see the temperature differences regardless of whether the sun's out or not.
Now, I mean, how is this actually helping police? I mean, how is this helping reduce crime? Because police are actually using this technology at the moment.
Yes, they are. Over 110 agencies in the U.S. are using this, and it allows them to act as a force multiplier. They can chase a criminal from the air, for example.
That's cool.
Well, what's happening now is what are we actually seeing here now? I think
like
the
like Casper
the suspect,
going for a jog.
The suspect is coming out of the car.
Now, you're gonna call.
Now, what's interesting here, he's hiding in the bushes. Now, usually you wouldn't be able to see him in the bushes. That's correct.
That's correct. In fact, if we switch to the TV camera, you won't be able to see much at all.
Now, we have a TV camera up in the helicopter, Tom, just to show you what you can see or what you can't with a normal camera. There you go. That's back on the infrared camera. Now, he's hiding in the bushes. And what's happening is our police officer down on the ground is in touch with a helicopter. And he's giving him advice. He's saying, yes, go and have a look in
there
the bushes. Is that correct?
There he is.
That's
Casper,
right. Now, he can direct
Lee
the police Krug, officer
the
to chase the suspect. So now there's been a situation where actually a suspect was hiding in the bushes right next to a helicopter, right next to a policeman, and he couldn't see him.
Yes, that's it was
incredible.
So dark, it was pitch black, and neither of them could see each other. So the officer in the air directed the officer on the ground to reach out, and he actually touched the suspect, and they both jumped from surprise.
Now, how is this actually helping police in sort of when we're doing high-speed chases? It's actually reducing the incidence of civilians being hurt.
Well, that's right. They can follow a car from the air. They don't have to create a high-speed chase situation, which is dangerous both for the police and for innocent bystanders.
Well, there you have it, Tom. That is infrared technology in action.
Wonderful.
The criminal is still running away. Hopefully, the policeman will catch him.
Yeah.
And we're going to show you exactly how infrared technology works a little bit later.
All right.
Yay!
Very nice. Antony Beilinsohn, who up until this morning, before Suzanne called in sick, thought he'd only be producing the segment, doing a bang-up job.
He did a really good job.
Didn't he? Yeah.
Very good. I would have never known the difference.
Danielle Brisebois says,
yay,
you're a natural, Antony.
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Yeah. He's so
whatever
good at accepting
but
compliments.
But Antony,
too,
who cut your hair, Ruth Buzzy? Look at Antony.
Antony checked out. He's gone.
He's out of here.
Hair can't be worse than film, can it now? Which we'll see in the second hour. But first, let's go to Jim, who's got, what do you got, Jim Weather?
Well, I've got what's coming up next.
Okay.
And we go to a playground where it never rains, snows, or sleets. Play space. Coming up on Breakfast Time.
This portion of FX is brought to you by the Florida Orange Growers. 100% pure Florida orange juice. It makes you feel so good.
Right now, John Morrison isn't thinking about cancer or the medical studies that conclude foods rich in vitamin C, like Florida orange juice, may actually help lower the risk of some types of cancer. So while
one minute to the top of the hour. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Tom. Jillian sitting here for Lori, Bob the puppet, and me, Jim. I'm the announcer, and here's the control room.
Yeah, Bob getting his Reiki healing here. Bob, how does it feel?
Nice.
Cool. Bob Hartnett is filling in for Chuck O'Neill, our regular director, while Chuck is in Las Vegas. Bob has directed and toured with the Grateful Dead. You've probably seen Walter Cronkite at those two concerts he attended. Yeah, that's right. But he's getting sort of the Breakfast Time experience. I bet they never gave you Reiki healing when you toured with Garcia. And I bet they gave you other things, though, didn't they? Yeah. Yeah, good quality stuff, too. All right, well, good. He's getting relaxed over there. And we have Danielle here with us, Joan.
Danielle Brisebois. Yes. Hey, guys.
Hey.
Thank you. From Annie, the youngest orphan in Annie, to Stephanie and all in the family on Archie Bunker's Place, to nightclubs. She's been around for a long, long time.
Oh my God.
And she's out with this new album, Danielle Brisebois, Arrive All Over You. And right now, before we get to talk to her, we're going to see a clip, What If God Fell From the Sky, Danielle Brisebois.
What if God fell from the sky? Would you notice? Just fall by. What if Christ took your hand and you just ran? Would you be
gorgeous. You went from the New York Children's Choir when you were young to Annie to nightclubs, and now you're doing something that's like Blondie, The Pretenders, this high-energy pop, and you co-wrote this album. So how did you make the choice? How did you decide, okay,
I'm going to go in another direction.
It's so funny you actually mentioned Blondie, because my whole life I was always singing. Like, Annie was singing, New York City Opera Company was singing, and Archie Bunker's Players was the first thing that I did was no music. And I got the Parallel Lines record by Blondie when I was about 10 and a half, 11, and I heard that record, and I was like, oh my God, this is what I have to do with my life. And so I did the acting, and then finally I just stopped because I really wanted to do music. I had to do it, and I felt that acting, I didn't want to be a slash, like actress slash singer.
Right.
I really wanted to commit to just doing music and really be honest with it.
When you're a child actor and you're just so involved in it for years, do you ever contemplate being anything other than in show business?
Oh,
do you ever say, I want to be a doctor or a fireman?
Well, see, I had to go to the doctor's one day and I thought I'd be a veterinarian because that'd be really fun. And I wanted to be an astronaut. And I think that's really the two main choices that I had when I was a kid.
So now, tell us a little bit about how you got into recording companies' executive offices, because this is very unconventional. I read a little bit about how you just went in there in a very unconventional way and got those record companies to listen.
You know, I was very determined to do this, like, on my own, and so I would read Billboard magazine, and they always have, like, these pictures from parties of people, like, you know, like, posing, like, Jillian and Danielle,
yeah,
friends,
right.
20
years.
Yeah, hey, at the BMG convention, those kind of things. And so I would, memorize, certain key people's faces. And then I'd find my way into parties, and I'd be like, hi, yeah, so I know this person who they were in the picture with or something. And I'd say, I'm mutual friends. I'd get to meet them. I'd start talking and kind of get going.
And you got a publishing deal, and then you got your recording contract. So let's hear it. Let's play us something.
Okay.
What are you going
to
do for us today?
Oh, right. Really early in the morning.
Everybody, that's right. Introduce your company.
This is my friend, Paul Gordon.
Hey, Paul.
Hey, Paul.
And,
everybody
okay.
Stand for this.
Yeah. Actually, the song we're going to do right now is
the national anthem.
It's not a song that I wrote, but it's a cover song for Bretton Woods from 1950.
Okay.
Give me a little time. The next single.
Sugar, if you don't want me, don't leave my arms.
PCI customers. Could this be you talking?
I expected a lower bill. I didn't get it.
We did not get the savings we were looking for.
Get on the bus. LX.
Now a little alternative adult non-contemporary music. By a waterfall, I'm calling you. Well, I would be calling you if your name was Cock-a-doodle-doo. Welcome back to Breakfast Time with Laurie Hibbert, Tom Bergeron, and Bob the Puppet. Sitting in for Laurie today is Jillian Hamilton. My name's Jim, and I'm the announcer to say good morning. Here's Tom.
Why, thank you. We're just hanging out in my office. This is fun because it's on a little bit of a delay. Let's watch.
Whee! Whee!
The waves, yeah, we're going to go in tighter. Can we go in tighter? We'll do an endless wave. Well, that's not as entertaining as I thought. We have Paul and Danielle Brisebois up
Yay.
Here. Being looked down on by Mo, Larry, and Curly here in the office. Jillian, what else is coming up on the show other than a guided tour of where I hang out after the program?
We've got Cowgirl Super Fashion with Cynthia Rowley. She's going to be winning an award for her new talent fashion design. We've also got the Wylands. We're going to give us some great ideas for those flu remedies and, of course, some news.
All right, good enough. And our road warriors all around the country. First, let's go to Phil Kogan down the road a piece here in Manhattan at Play Space, where he's having a heck of a Tonka time.
All right, we got to wash those dishes right. Yes, thank you, Tom. We're just chilling. We're ironing. Could I have some milk in the tea there, please? And we got to chop this pizza up right here. We're learning about life here. This is a special play space, which is for a 6-month-old to 6-year-old, and it's unique. Take a look around. There are a lot of parents around here, and I'm the biggest kid, believe me. We're all having a wonderful time, and when we come back, we'll tell you what is so special about it.
All right, good enough. Joining us in Fort Lauderdale, where he's searching for gators, and he found one.
Yeah.
Hey, cool. John Davis has been eaten by this alligator in the Everglades.
What do you think, Tom? We found a 12-foot gator. Pretty cool, huh?
That is pretty cool.
All right. We'll admit it. We're not out in the wild anymore.
Oh, cheater.
I know. It was too cold out there. They're not coming to the surface. But when we come back, we're going to take an up-close look at Cannibal, the 12-foot alligator.
Wait, Danielle said what?
I collect alligators. I named my publishing company Gator Baby because I love alligators.
We'll bring this one back for you.
Yeah.
You have, like, pet alligators?
No, I just, not real alligators, you know, fake ones. But I love alligators. I've gone to the Everglades just to see them.
I was suddenly not as comfortable turning my back to you. And Suzanne Wong has a little stomach virus. She is taking the day off. But in her place, quite unexpectedly,
Yay.
He found out early this morning and doing a fine job.
Yay.
Her producer, Antony Beilinsohn, is in Portland, Oregon, showing us the wonders of heat-seeking technology. Antony?
Good morning. Okay, before we showed you a great shot from the helicopter, let's get the shot again. That's me down here waving. I don't know if you can see that. That's us from the helicopter with infrared technology.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to send our criminal off running so you can get a shot, a look at him again. There he is. When we come back, we're going to show you exactly how infrared technology works and how they're able to take our heat and turn it into pictures.
Serpentine.
And also show you some amazing differences. And also show you some amazing differences between men and women that only infrared can detect.
Sounds good. I'm up here on the third floor, our office area, because in a moment, Cassandra Danz, our own Mrs. Green Thumbs, is going to show us plants that you can't possibly kill. Also coming up this hour, we're going to be exercising with Joan Collins. Either she's going at a faster speed or she's very limber. I'm not sure.
That's how you face them and trim.
It's like the Keystone Cops workout. What is this? Yeah. It must be the tape speed.
Hollywood people live fast.
They do. And right now, let's take a look at some of today's stories.
50-minute workout in 2 minutes.